will record this. Okay, so today will be the fourth module of this class, right? I will, we have already studied about the concept of the basic idea of C programming, starting from the data type, and then how can we declare the variables, many variables. And then, so today we have to know about the control system in C programming, right? That is important because when we are talking about computer, compute means to calculate something, right? So you expect that your computer will calculate something and print it out from onto the screen. So in order to do that, your program has to be written like in systematically to control the computer. So in this chapter, we will study about the essentials of the culture control repetition. This is about the, for simply speaking, it will be for loop, right? Why? Because it is, we have the culture, right? And for loop will be the easiest construct in C programming that you will understand easily. And then after you are familiar with the for loop, right? We also have the while loop and do while loop, right? Okay, that is also the repetition statement that you have to understand. And in this class, we also talk about the switch selection and break and continue statement that will be useful in the future. And also we use the logical operator in order to form the complex conditional expression in control statements, right? Okay, that will be the overall of what we are going to talk today. And also this class will be very important. So in this chapter, we will talk about, I just told you that we will talk about for loop and do while loop. Maybe I forgot to write while loop. Maybe while loop is similar to for loop, right? Mm-hmm. And we also will talk about the more complex of the if-else clause, that is switch case, right? We can use switch case in order to make your program clean and easy to understand. And when we use the switch case or even for the for loop, right? What you have to know about is suppose you want to go out of the loop immediately, you might have to use the break and continue. You can use either break or continue, right? And they will have different meanings, right? Okay, so we'll start from the selection and the sequence. We have already studied about C programming in terms of the sequential programming, right? What does it mean by sequential programming? You have to execute one instruction or one statement at a time, right? One after another, right? Sequence means we have to start from, this is the first step, start, and then second step, we'll do step A, then do step B, and then do step C, and then end, right? So this is a five steps of this sequence, okay? We have five steps, right? So in this way, you know exactly what will be going on, right? Starting from the 1, 2, 3, right? And so on. But for selection step, right? You start from the start and end with end. But you will have to concern about what we call conditional statement or conditional expression. What does it mean by conditional expression? Conditional expression will be like an expression that you have to evaluate, right? If you evaluate it as true, so it will go to one direction. Otherwise, or if you evaluate it as no, it will go another side, right? Different sides. So it will be yes or no in flowchart. If the condition holds true or yes, we will go to this direction, right? And then for selection, right, in flowchart, you will have the merging point. Sometimes we can call connector. Connector we will use in this page, or we'll use the connector for connecting two page, right? The first and the second page, right? Okay, so in this flow chart, right? Because we have already passed this one, right? So I know that you understand about this clearly, okay? About the selection flow chart. So today we will talk about the loop, right? Loop is very important. I have told you that because it is the computer is a calculator, right? It's a big calculator, let's say. So the duty or the function of the computer will be to repeatedly perform or process something, right? So the most, one of the most important constructs that you have to use is the loop, right? The loop, right? From the previous lab, right? Maybe you found out that you meet some troubles if you don't have because last week I have not yet taught you about the loop control, right? But someone, like some students, know beforehand about the loop programming, so it doesn't matter, you can use it. But someone who have no idea about the loop, right, or you don't know, you have not studied about the loop statement, you have to use it repeatedly. What does it mean by that? You have to copy one statement and then and so on, right? Oh, so that's not the problem, right? As long as you can have or you can come up with the same output, so it doesn't matter that you will write the program, okay? You can write any piece of code, right? You can write different piece of code. And that's also a good way as well, because so I will know that what is the stage of C programming for each of you. For someone, maybe you just the beginner, someone is a novice, or someone will be the expert, right? So I can understand, or I will know that your level of C programming level. Okay, so in order to write the loop, right? Okay, this is just the explanation. You can go back and have a look at this, right? But what I'm trying to say is that if the most important or the basic loop will be for loop. If you want to write a for loop, okay, C program, right? For loop, for we will have. Three part. The reason why we call for loop is a control counter control repetition, because inside the for loop, right, maybe you have to, okay, we will declare integer I, right, and for loop, right, is very easy, right? So you have this one is the basic for loop, right? You may have to remember or memorize this one. For I is equal to zero, because the for C programming you have to start from zero, right? Index, okay. But if you don't want to be confused, so I will start from I is equal to one, and then I for the second part of the for loop, it will be the conditional statement I less than or equal to 10. If you want to do for 10 loops. Right. If you want to do 10 loops, right, of I, right, starting from one, right, this one will be we call the first part is the initialization. We want to initialize the variable. For example, we want to start the integer I from one, so you can set it up as a one I is equal to one and semicolon. This is the first part of the loop. And then this one is a ending or termination condition. This is the condition for ending this loop, right? If you want to go out of the loop, right, you have to check whether I is equal or less than or equal to 10. If I is not less than or equal to 10, it will go out of the loop. And the last one will be easily, you can use I++, right? Do you remember this one, right? I++, this is the incrementer. I++, that is exactly the same, is I is equal to I+1, right? You want to make it shorter, right? C programmer is lazy, right? So you want to make it shorter. So you can just simply use I++, or in this case, you can use ++I as well. There are some different between these two forms. I will talk about this later. Okay, so this way you have to, okay, for for loop, right? You have to for loop, this is format, and then end up with one statement. Only one statement will be executed inside this loop. What if you want to have more than one statement inside the loop for, what shall we do? If I want to, if I want to print out, let me like this. For I is equal to 1, I less than or equal to 10, and then I++. If I want to print I, so I use print f. %ID, right? \n, and then I, right? So in this way, it will print out 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, and 10, right? Like this. Okay, this is a for loop. For loop will execute only, as I just told you, only one sentence. But if I if I want to print out, if I want to execute more than one statement, what shall I do? I will use braces like this. Okay, I will use like this, and then I will, okay, in, I'll give you some example. I will statement 1, semicolon, statement 2, semicolon. So this is a for loop, okay? For loop is really simple, right? I suggest you, right? If you are the beginner of C programming, I suggest you to use for loop because you can count or you can know the number or the number of steps in advance. For this example, you can count like this one. How many loops in this for? So just 10 loops. Why? It's easy, right? You can just simply see this one and this one from 1 to 10, right? So you have 10 loops. So it will it's very easy to understand. Okay. And the next thing that I would like to show you is that in C programming, we have two kinds of loop, for loop and while loop, right? I just told you that you have while loop and for loop and another one, right? And while loop, okay, I will change it to, if I want to, okay, while loop and for loop is, I would say this in my sense, right, for the programmer sense is exactly the same. But will I just told you that it will be a bit more difficult to know how many loops for while loop, right? But if I will show you that. So for while loop, right, you have to while loop the syntax of while loop is just like while loop. Why? You have to just simply check to do loop. X is less than or equal to 10, right? For while loop, if you want to convert from for loop, right? You have to start from, okay, this is initialization. Initialization I is equal to 1, it will be out of the while loop. And for the terminal or termination condition, you will put inside the relational expression inside the while. And then you can use braces in order to show the body of the loop, right? Body inside the loop, right? Body, you can call this as a body, right? So in this, inside this as well, right? We can call this as a body. But for while loop, right? Because we are, this one we have I plus plus in while loop as well. You have to put I plus plus right before this ending braces, right? Before this right ending, right braces here. Mm-hmm. So you can see that they will execute exactly the same while and for loop. Right? So you can use for or while loop interchangeably. Okay. So we call this one is a counter control repetition. And it can be convert into the flow chart like this. Okay. X, this one is initialization, right? And this one will be okay. In C programming, right? Maybe for the human perception, you will start from the natural number 1 to 10. But in C programming, right, normally we'll use 0 to 9, right? X is less than 10, right? So sometimes we will write for loop like it's for I from 0 to I less than 10, right? So when I write like this, right, the reason I use 10 because I want to indicate that this we have 10 loops. Okay, so that's why I start from 0 and then less than 10 instead of less than or equal to 10, right? So how many numbers of the loops, right? Starting from 0, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 9, right, until 9. Once I is equal to 10, the for loop will be going out. So in this case, right, we have to, okay, do task, right? Do task will be inside the body, okay? And this one will be increment X and increment step will be this part. It's a question. To show I plus plus same. Not exactly the same, Boone. I would say like this. Okay, if you ask this question, so I will answer this one. Okay, let's go back. Okay. Actually, if we use I plus plus or plus plus I alone, right? It will be exactly like I is equal to I plus one, like this. But if I start from I is equal to 5, okay, I like 5, then I plus plus will be 6 in this step, right? I will be 6. Suppose this is the memory of I, right? First I will be 5 and then I plus plus will be 6 and plus plus I will be 7, something like this. Okay, this is what the I plus plus and plus plus I does. But if I change a bit, before I will go to tell you about the meaning of I plus plus and plus plus I plus plus mean do first, increment later. Do you understand what I mean? do first increment later but purpose I means increment first do later so in this case if I have a program like this I is equal to I plus plus and I is equal to plus plus I what does this mean in this step right I will show you step by step carefully okay in this way if this is I right I is equal to 5 so I press I here maybe I don't want to make you confused so can I just a little bit change this to J and this one is K okay in order to make it clear for you right and we also have one two more okay now I is equal to 5 this step right and this step what is J is 5 or 6 this step right this step will be changed to this J is equal to I do first increment later do first increment I later the step will be like this so what will be the value of J J will be 5 correct thank you very much J will be 5 and I
will be 6 yes
will be 6 I will be 6 now step by step okay and then how about k increment first do later so this one will be plus plus I first and then k is equal to I this is the meaning of this one you can split this complex statement into like into two statements like this so it will be like so when we execute this step I will be increment first to 7 and then 7 which is I will be 7 not 7 in I 7 I that is 7 will be assigned to k so k will be 7 so you have to be careful okay let me go back to the previous example right about I if I change no see if it's a bit okay I is equal to 5 again I is equal to I plus plus I equal to plus plus I okay so first I will be 5 right and then this step will be I is equal to I and then I plus plus am I right what is the result now do it first six. So then I is equal to 5 for the first step and then I will be 6 later okay so it seems like but I know that this one the second step the next step I is equal to plus plus I if I is 6 so this one will be 7 in order to prove this one, we might have to write a program. But I think it's like this, because it will do first assign I to I first, and then execute I++. So after this step, right, actually we have two expression in this step, right? So it will be six. And then plus plus I is very special. You have to do first, increment first, and then assign the value of the incrementation to I. So I will be seven. Mm-hmm. So let's see this carefully. Okay, this is a difference between I++ and ++I. So for I minus minus and minus minus I will be the same. Okay, will be similar, not the same. Okay, this is an example of how to use the counter controlled repetition by using while loop, right? This is very easy, right? You can just use the counter in order to, okay, for the repetition or for the iteration, right? So it's fine to use I++, but if I use other variable like, right, mm-hmm. Okay, so this is an example of how to use while loop, right? So you need to initialize first. Okay, initialize first and then find the repetition condition and then use the increment step, increment statement, right? Mm-hmm. So this is an example of while loop. And this is for loop. I've told this already, right? For loop, start from the initialization and loop continuation condition. And then this one is the increment of control variables. I would say that there could be more than one statement inside this loop. For example, if I use for I is equal to 0, comma j is equal to 0, and semicolon. This will be the two statements for initialization. We can use two more than one statements. It's not a problem, but you have to connect them with the comma, not semicolon. Semicolon will be used for expressing three parts of inside the for loop. Okay. One part, two part, and three part. Okay. So today, if you are new to C programming, I suggest you to use for loop first. Okay, so that's why I focus on for loop. Mm-hmm. Okay, this one is to convert from the while loop for the previous example into for loop, right? So you can just very easy to write it in terms of for counter from 1 to counter less than or equal to 10 and then plus plus counter and then print out counter. This is exactly the same as what I wrote. Okay, only one. What does it mean by percent sign u here? Percent sign u is similar to percent sign d, but it will be stand for the, it is a format for the unsigned integer. If you have known in advance that your counter will not be less than 0 or the negative number, so you can specify it as the unsigned integer counter, right? Once again, right? Normally, when you when you design a program, right, and you want to make a loop, right, and you have known in advance that counter cannot be negative, so you can specify it as an unsigned integer. So make sure that your integer will not be decreased or will be decremented until it is less than zero, right? So unsigned integer will be used in the case like this. Okay, please remember that, right? But normally when you use the for loop, you can just simply assign like decade like integer I, integer j, that's all. But it's not safe. When you write a program, right, in C program, you need to concern about the safety of your program. What does it mean by safety? You have to avoid the unexpected situation. You have to avoid unexpected unexpected event. For example, if you use counter, that's possible that you can use minus minus counter and then loop until counter is less than zero. And you have known in advance that your counter or the number of students in this class or anything else that that must be positive number, right? You have to let it like this to guarantee that your value will not less than zero. Okay, unsigned integer. This is a flowchart to show you about another kinds of the while loop. Actually, it is also, it can be represent for loop as well, right? Starting from counter and they check for the condition and then counter plus plus, right? Plus plus counter, right? So when you want to convert from this one into this one flow chart, right? So it will be exactly the same. Okay. Up to now, do you have any questions? Okay, this is a comparison between the for loop, for syntax for and syntax while, right? So for loop, you have three parts, right? Expression one, two, and three, right? Expression one will be copied to this. Expression two, we copy to this if you want to convert from for loop syntax to while loop syntax. And then expression three, which is incrementer, we remove to this. Okay, do you get the point? And the statement right here, you can like this. Okay, this is so I can say that these two statements can be used interchangeably. Okay. In lab in the afternoon, right? We are going to try to implement or try to write a program in this this slide. Okay, you have to try to type by yourself, right? One by one, right? And try to run it. Right. Okay. So you can understand more about the program, right? I'm not going to write a program now, right? I will write and show them in the afternoon. Okay. For this example, if we want to sum from, from the previous example, we can just only want to print out the number, right? Or the label 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7 to 10. And if you want to sum them, so it's really easy, you can just use this, right? Sum. Okay. If when I want to write a program, right, to sum, okay, I have to start from include. stdio.h and then integer main. I will use braces right after main here, and then I will not forget to put the right braces here. Okay, I suggest you to write a program like me, like this, right? Because this one integers and this will match to this one. Okay, so I will not move this one to this one, right? Because I will forget, but it doesn't matter, right? But my style, I like to use like this because it will be exactly the same as a format for for loop and while loop as well. Okay, so if I want to, to sum, I want to do this sum I from 1 to n. This I, right? Achan, is it possible to put statement in for loop by using one line? Yes. For loop, right? The expectation for for loop is for loop will execute, okay, like this for blah, 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 blah. And then for loop will expect to execute loop. Just only this single statement. Only one statement will be executed, right? Only one statement, which is written right after for loop will be executed. But if you want one more than one statement, you can just simply use braces to show and to put, you can put many statements inside the braces and that's all. Okay. I'm not sure whether I answer your question, but I will continue with this one. So what do we do next? I want to sum, right? So maybe I have to print out integer I first, and then maybe print f, enter the number. And then scan f. Maybe I will have to, okay. Get num, right? And also I have to use sum, right? Sum. I num sum, and then scan. Because I don't have enough space, right? I use scan like this, and ampersand num, semicolon. So I have to initialize sum first. I will be initialized in for loop. Num will be initialized by scanf, but sum has not yet initialized. What is the number of sum to be initialized in this case? If I want to find summation, I from 1 to n, what is the initialization here? 0, right? 0. I use this one because I want to make it different between all. Okay, and then for loop, for i is equal to 1, right? Initialization, and I less than or equal to num, right? I plus plus, and then so sum is equal to sum plus I, right? Because we want to sum 1, 2, plus 3, plus 4, and so on until num, right? This is what we are trying to do. So then I write sum is equal to sum plus, okay, first I is 1. 1 will be sum plus sum. First sum is 0 plus 1 will be 1. So after the first loop, sum will be 1. And then when true, okay, one step further, right? I is equal to I plus plus, so 2 and sum is 1. 2, 1, 1 plus 2 is 3, and so on, right? So this will be if you want to sum up from 1 to num, okay? And the last step, you have to print this. From this case, because there is only one line here, so you don't have to put braces. You don't have to put braces. So that's all. And then the last step will be print in F, summation is percent sign D, and then sum. Okay, this is a program to write to find the summation from 1 to 2 num, right? Input. Why we don't use I equal to 1 or to I? Inside the loop, right? This is a conditional statement. We will have to do this loop as long as I is still less than or equal to num. But if I use I equal to num, it's not what we mean. This means this loop will repeat if I is equal to num. That is not correct. We will do this loop while I is still less than num, less than or equal to num. Okay, thank you. Okay, to sum 1 from 1 plus 2 plus 3 until num. Okay, but from the previous example, we just want to sum only the even numbers from 2 to 100. So it will be exactly the same as this one, this program, but you have to step. You have to start from 2 and then end up with 100. Okay, this one you can set as the same, but for this phase, the increment step, it could be a decrement as well, right? Not just increment. You can use number is equal to number plus 2, right? You have to be 2 plus 4 plus 6, right? So the difference between 2 and 4 will be 2. 4 and 6 will be 2. So you have to use plus 2 here. So if you want to make it shorter, you can make it shorter by using num plus equal to. Num plus equal to mean num is equal to number plus 2. Okay. So I think it's still okay. Still happy? Okay, this is an example, right? You can try to use to find the compound interest calculation, right? By using this formula, right? Starting from the invest $1,000, right? The original amount, so P will be $1,000 and R will be the annual interest rate. So in this case, it is 5% interest, and then we want to find the compound interest for 10 years. So it is 10. So what you have to do is you have to maybe, starting from 1,000 and then 5% interest. So you have 1,050, right? Well, plus 5% and so on, right? You can find 10 steps. You can try in the lab, okay? And we'll be in the lab. This is an example of the program, okay? I will go back and talk to this later. There is a caution for using for loop, right? Because normally when we use, I suggest you to be the counter in your loop, right? So I suggest you to use integer from the previous examples, many previous examples. But could it be possible if you use for loop and instead of using I as an integer and you use floating and double? It's possible, right? Because for loop, there is no restriction or limitation that you cannot use floating point, no. But for loop, you can also use floating points, right? But it's still, you have to be careful.
Mm-hmm.
You have to be careful about this. And okay, this is also an important thing that you have to keep in mind. When you keep floating point, right? Floating point we have, when you keep it, it's just an estimation or approximate. Floating point and double is just an approximate value. What does it mean by that? Because, okay, if you calculate this one, right, this is a floating point, right? Even it is printed out as 14.23 for two digits, right? Two digits. But the actual value inside this floating point may be 14.234, okay, 234. And another one will be, okay, like this, 18.673. Mm-hmm. Maybe it's not just three, maybe it might be, oh, okay, four plus four. Maybe I should, correct. Two, three, four. Okay, this one is four. Four, this one, right? The actual value of this is this, and actual value of this is this. 7, 8. Okay. When you plus two floating point or two doubles, right? Actually you want to, okay, like in your banking account, right? You have the things only shown in your account, in your banking account is just two digits, right? Right after the decimal point. Okay, so it's from this value, it expect to print out 32.90. Am I right? 32.90 because 3 plus 7 is 10, 0, right? But the actual value of the floating point is like this and like this. So when you sum them up, right, you can get, you have to round, right? 32.907, when you round it, right? When you round it, it will be like this. So you have to be careful. So don't be surprised that sometimes for the summation of the floating point or double values, right, you come up with unexpected values. So maybe you have to think about it as there are some round up error, right? So this one you have to round up error. That could be possible, okay? So in this case, I don't know how can we let them print out like this. This is 32 plus 09. Maybe you have to check about this letter. Okay. Okay, 1 hour. So I will give you about 10 minutes break, right? And then we will come back again. You can drink, you can go to the toilet, and then we will come back again and see you at 11:30. Thank you. Okay, the next construct that I would like to introduce to you today as well, because it is the if you know do while, right? You know why, Luke. You need to know the why as well, right? What is a differences between why loop and do why loop? Okay, it's very simple. Do why loop, you don't have to check for the condition before you go to the loop. You can go to the loop first and then check later. Okay, do loop first. Check means check condition later, right? But for while loop, you have to check first. Do loop later, okay? This is just the difference between do while loop and while loop, right? So you can just change it, but there's some what you call the limitation or the conditions that you have to use do why or why do. For example, if you want to get integer, for the previous slide, you have to get number, right? Get number to some only the even numbers, right? But if the input is negative, what do? If the we normally do the while loop for getting the input, right? The correct input. For example, I use do while like this. Okay, do while. Scan if, right? I will have to scan until the number is greater than 0. So I have to write do while loop. Why? We repeat entering the input while number is less than or equal to 0, something like this. So maybe someone want to ask me what is the case, right? Because while loop and do while loop is almost exactly the same, right? But the special case or the case that we use that as a just thing can think now is the how to input to get the input. You have to get input first, and then you have to check for the correctness or the valid of your input. For example, this is a fun number. You need a number will be number, right? So the number will be greater than or equal to 1, right? So if the number is less than or equal to 0, right? You have to re-enter about it, right? So in this way, you have to repeat to get the number. For example, if you are trying to write a program in order to get a username and password of the ATM machine, right? So you need to do is you have to do while loop, right? Get the password. If the password is not correct, you have to re-enter it again and then decrease the number of the count. Just in case that if you have just only 3 times for the wrong password, right, and then the card will be we cannot be used, right? The machine will get your card back, right, for something like this. So in this case, you may have to do at maximum 3 loops. Okay, maybe in this case you have to write a program to do like this. Okay, do you understand? This is a good example of how to use do while loop. Just only one example. Okay. So this is the flowchart of the do while loop, right? As I just said, it is the do first, check later. Do first, check later. Okay. Easy to understand. Oh, here we come to the switch, right? Multiple selection statement. We have already talked about the if clause. If else clause, right? We have already studied that. And then if else if, right? And then else, right? We have already talked about this already. So in this case, if you want to use the switch, switch will be very useful for a variable or expression to be tested, right? If you have done in advance that we have the specific data type of the value that we are going to evaluate it. For example, normally when we use switch case, we use this format switch value. Value mean the value that you are going to check whether what is the case of it. Okay, case one, do action. Case two, do this action. Right. And if there is no case that match case one or case two, you can also use default. Default is an optional. For the syntax, if you write bracket like this, it's optional. Optional means you don't have to put the default, but it doesn't matter, right? So for like this, if you use service like this, case two, case one and case two. So if you get case T will not do anything, just go out from the switch. Only case one will do this, case two will do this. No, but this case, right, it will be like this. If the value, if value is equal to character one, you have to do action one and action two. Action one, action two. Why? Because if this case collect all the statements after it will be executed. So action one, action two will be executed except default. Default is exceptional case, right? It's not equal to one or two. And then, so if it's action one and action two will do and then go out. If value is equal to two, only action two will do and then go out. If value is other case, other than one or two, like three, four, right? Actions here, actions can be done, can be executed only. So what if we want to make it normal? Normal in what sense? When we select case one, right? Action one will do only and then stop and then go out. So what should we do is you have to put one. One statement break here and break here. For the typical switch, there is no break, okay? Let me think like this, there is no break. But if you get case one, where you case one, right? And then execute only action one and then go out. So you have to put, don't forget to put break. Break means when you meet break, it will skip the nearest braces. Break will go out of the nearest braces or body, right? Normally when we call this one like a body, right? The nearest braces or nearest loop. Actually, inside the service is not a loop, right? But we can think like this. And this is very important for switch case. Only the value that you can use for value will be integer type only. What does it mean by integer type only? So character is possible, integer is possible, long is possible. That's why we can use this one, character one. Remember, this is character one, right? It's not equal to one. What is a character, ASCII code of character one? What is a ASCII code of one? Or the value of one? Integer one is one. Character one is 49. ASCII code. So in this case, it means that case one here means 49. Case two here means 50. How can I remember that? Because I just simply remember zero. Zero is 48. Character A is 65. Character small a is 90. Thank you, admin. I'm getting older. I always forget about this. Okay, 97. Mm-hmm. Okay, this is switch case, right? Normally I use switch case for the grading. If I want to write an application to grade the score of the students, right? To be A, B, C, or something like this, right? So I use the switch case, right? To grade the student. So this is an example of how to make use of the switch case. Okay, sometimes we have to use a big capital A and capital and small a, capital B, small b, right? We can use this. We can use this, right? You see this? Case B and case B, right? And don't forget to put break here, right? To exit the switch, okay? Multiple selection. Okay, and another important thing is that you may have to know that it's a break, right? Break means you will skip out of the loop or the nearest bases or nearest body, right? This is a break, right? We have already talked to you. And you don't have to check for the loop condition anymore. When you say break, it means break, go out of the loop. But continue is different. Continue means if you see this this statement continue, continue will go out of the loop. But if it is in the while loop or for loop, if you have to go back and check whether the condition is the terminal condition or termination condition or not. If it's not the termination condition, you have to repeat the loop. So this is just the differences between the break and continue. Break means stop, go out of the loop. But continue means go out of the loop, that current loop, and then go back to check it whether it is still the condition meets. If the condition still meets, so you have to continue doing that. Okay, do you get the point? Do you understand about the break, the difference between the break and continue? When I want to give the real world application of break and continue, break means if you broke up with your girlfriend or boyfriend, right? If you completely don't go back, oh, he is still good to me, he is still love me. Okay, if you do like that, it is continue. You go back to check the condition that he is still good, and then you go back and then do the loop of being your boyfriend, girlfriend. But for break, right? Stop is stop. No more thinking about his condition. Go on, move on. Okay, break is just a break. It might be easy for you to understand about the difference between the break and continue. okay, as its name. Okay, maybe you can have a look this example where you can just type it, right? Bake, right? Use bake for this example and use continue in this example, right? And you can see, right? Okay, so for the break, right? As I just told you, right? Because it is the loop of 10 loops, right? And this one is very easy, right? You can just simply check if it is 5, then stop, then break. Break means go out of the loop. So if you use break, right? You will print only 1, 2, 3, and 4. But in the opposite, right? If you use continue, right? It will skip only 5, 1, 2, 3, 4, and 5 is missing, and then continue, go back 6, 7, 8, 9, 10. This is just change back to continue. Do you understand? For back, right? Go out of the loop and will not do it again. But for continue, you can just simply skip only that condition and then go back to the loop again and continue the loop. Okay, I think you get this point. And this is the end of today class. But before we will go for lunch and then we will meet again. Okay, this is the announcement. We'll meet again at 1:30, right? And we will do the lab together. Okay, we will have to combine four classes or four rooms together. Okay, and we'll try to write the program together. Because before I leave, right, I want to show you one thing, right? Because in C programming, we don't have what we call Boolean data type. Do you know Boolean or Boolean? Sorry, I have to say Boolean. Booleans mean the value of Boolean can be only true or false. In C programming, we don't have the data type to show you true or false only. In C programming, if you want to show the value of false, you can use integer type 0. 0 means false. Any integer means true. Or in some compilers, sometimes they use 1 as a true and 0 as a false. Okay, so when you have like A is greater than 10, right? The meaning of A is greater than 10, if A is equal to 11, 11 greater than 10, so it will return 1 or other integer, any other integer, that's all. But if A is equal to 9, A greater than 10 is false, it will be false. It will be, this one will be evaluated to be 0, integer 0. So sometimes if we use if, right? So if we evaluate the condition here, relational condition here in terms of the integer, okay? So you have to keep in mind that this is the things that you have to be careful, because we don't have the true or false or Boolean data type. So you have to use integer to represent the Boolean data type or Boolean true or false by yourself. But for sure, every C compiler false is 0, but true is not. So you have to be careful about this, right? So you can also use assignment statement for this. I is equal to A greater than 10, right? If A is equal to 9, I will be 0. I will be 0 if A is equal to 9, but if A is equal to 11, maybe 1. to be assigned to I or positive number. Okay. So the result to be uncertain. Uncertain. So this is uncertainty in C programming, depends upon the C compiler, but you have to, okay, as you are the good programmer, you have to be careful about this and don't let the relational statement will be assigned into a variable, like in this case, and then you will go on. Okay, you can just check true or false of the relational expression only. So you will be happy and have no questions or no doubt about the value, exact value of the Boolean type, if it is true. Okay, so before you leave this class, please type 9 to check for your class attendance in the morning, and then you can go for lunch. Have a bon appetit for your lunch, and we'll meet you again at 1:30. Thank you very much. So we move the class from Friday to Monday. Yes, I will try to move the class from Friday to Monday, but only for the online class that will be possible. And I always have the department meeting for Monday afternoon, right? So the first Monday of each month, it's not possible for me to conduct the course, but I will talk to my TA, right? Whether my TA can help me or not. Okay, I try to move this if we still have the online class, but okay, for this week, I will still meet you online for Monday and Friday. Because if you remember that we skipped one class for Queen Sirikit's Mother Day, right? We have no class on that. So we have to, I need one makeup class that would be today and then Friday. And okay, but if we can go on site, actually, we can go on site, except me, I'm still afraid of the COVID, right? If I think I can go to the university, we have to come back to Friday again because the lab. I'm not sure about the room of the lab, but it's possible because normally Monday afternoon, we don't have the class, right? Maybe I will reserve the rooms for you. Mm-hmm. Anyone in this room at the university? No? Okay, let us talk about it later on during the afternoon class, okay? Bye-bye. เดี๋ยวค่อยมาคุยตอนใหม่นะคะอย่าลืมเช็คชื่อนะอ